It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Why is the Premier allowing Orange Air to lease a helicopter from Augusta Westland, the very same company involved in the original Orange Air scandal currently being investigated by the OPP?
Well, Mr. Speaker, as the member opposite knows, there have been massive changes made at Orange. There was a whole investigation, Mr. Speaker. The governance has changed. The individuals involved have changed, Mr. Speaker. There's a new board. So, Mr. Speaker, I don't know the details of that specific decision, Mr. Speaker. But what I do know is that Orange is a different and a revitalized organization. And, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care will want to speak to the specifics.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The name on the Premier's door may have changed, but what goes on behind it sadly remains the same. On March 7th, Orange Air issued a notice of its intention to negotiate the lease of an AW-139 helicopter from Finamerica, the parent company of Augusta Westland. There was no public tender. Orange says this is sole-sourced because this company is the only source that can deliver by June 30th. Mr. Speaker, why is the Premier allowing Orange Air to crawl back into bed with their partners in this scandal?
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, let me just say, and I actually had the opportunity to meet a couple of Orange pilots in a small northern airport recently, and what's really critical to me and to our government, and I would think to all members of this place, Mr. Speaker, is that Orange is able to provide the very, very best service to the people of Ontario when they need it, Mr. Speaker. That is of the greatest concern. And so, Mr. Speaker, as I say, the organization has been completely changed. There are new personnel, Mr. Speaker, new governance, and those changes were made as a result of an investigation, Mr. Speaker, obviously into challenges and problems that were at that organization. Those changes have been made, Mr. Speaker, and as I say, in terms of the specific decision, we can certainly look into that in greater depth, but what's important to me, Mr. Speaker, is that people across this province get the service
that they need
from them.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Premier is allowing the fox back into the henhouse. It was 4 years ago today that the auditor issued his report on Orange Air's shady dealings with Augusta Westland. The auditor found that Orange Air paid Augusta $148 million U.S. for 12 helicopters when they only needed 9 helicopters. Augusta then kicked back $2.9 million U.S. into Orange's foundation, and then they kicked back again $4.8 million for future marketing. All of these shady deals are currently being investigated by the OPP. Mr. Speaker, why is the Premier allowing this deal to go on?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. We are very proud of the work that Orange is doing in this province. In fact, they travel through their helicopters and fixed-wing aircraft more than 6 million miles across the province, transporting more than 18,000 ill and often critically ill patients. Orange is well into a new chapter, Mr. Speaker, with a culture that puts patients first, and the surveys that have been done with patients in terms of measuring their satisfaction they're exemplary, Mr. Speaker. I'm so proud of our new CEO. I'll be meeting him in the coming days, Mr. Speaker. We have a new board of directors, as the Leader of the Opposition clearly knows, a new senior management team. This is a new era for Orange. I'm proud of the work that they do. I'm proud of the work that the frontline healthcare workers working for Orange do every day. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the Opposition.
My question, Mr. Speaker, is for the Premier. The Health Minister may be proud, as he says, of a sole-source deal being investigated by the OPP, but let's get into the facts. There is only one word to describe Orange Air's new deal with Augusta, Mr. Speaker, and that's shady. In February of last year, Orange Air said it was looking to sell the helicopters they bought from Augusta. At that time, the Orange CEO, Andrew McCallum, said they were too expensive to maintain. He also said that few other agencies would even think of using these helicopters as an air ambulance. So, Mr. Speaker, can the Premier explain why on earth would Orange now be looking at purchasing and leasing these helicopters?
You know, Mr. Speaker, there is no doubt that there were huge challenges at this organization, which is why there have been huge changes, Mr. Speaker, which is why the governance has changed, the individuals have changed, Mr. Speaker. And so the fact is, as the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care has said, it really is a new culture at Orange, including new structures and new people involved, Mr. Speaker. I think it should be of prime concern to all of us that those 18,000 patients get the service that they require, that they get to the hospitals that they need, Mr. Speaker, that they get to the health care professionals that they need, and that is done in the most expeditious way possible. That's what's happening. 6 million kilometres a year, Mr. Speaker, 18,000 patients. It's extremely important that we recognize that this is an important job that these frontline health care workers do.
Thank you.
We support them in that.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. Nothing about this deal makes sense. Last December, just 4 months ago, Orange cancelled its plan to sell the Augusta helicopters. At that time, Dr. McCallum questioned the original decision to buy the helicopters. So why then is Orange looking to lease the very same helicopter that the CEO said was too expensive to maintain and not suited for the job? Mr. Speaker, I asked the Premier, who is going to benefit from this deal? It's not the Ontario taxpayers. I need an explanation for this.
Thank you. Premier?
Well, again, I know the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care will want to comment in the final supplementary, but, Mr. Speaker, the only answer to who is going to benefit from a decision that is made at Orange is the patients, Mr. Speaker.
That's right.
That is who will benefit. That's why we made the changes that we made, Mr. Speaker. All of the changes that we made were in aid of making sure that patients were at the centre of those decisions. So, Mr. Speaker, that's who will benefit. Those 18,000 patients a year who need the service of Orange, who need those highly trained professionals to be at their best, that's who will benefit from decisions that are made at Orange, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Auditor General didn't say the Orange scandal was benefiting patients. It said taxpayers and the people of Ontario were being ripped off. And the reality is, the Auditor said millions of dollars were wasted because the government let the Orange executives run wild. Well, the same thing is happening today. The Premier said she would be different. When she was Health Minister, the Deputy Premier said she would keep a close eye on Orange. But what we have, Mr. Speaker, is the Orange scandal 2.0. If the Premier knew about this deal, shame on her. If the Premier didn't know about this deal, shame on her again. Is it any wonder the people of Ontario don't trust this government? Will the Premier pick up the phone? Will she cancel the shady lease? Yes or no? Don't pass the buck. Yes or no? Will you cancel the shady lease?
Thank you.
You were silent in Ottawa.
Start the clock. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. This is a very serious matter. You know, it was a very serious matter that there needed to be changes made at Orange, and those changes were made, Mr. Speaker. There is new governance at Orange. There is a new culture, Mr. Speaker. There is a culture that focuses on the best interests of patients, Mr. Speaker. The allegations that the Leader of the Opposition is making, I have no idea what they are based in, Mr. Speaker. I do not know the nature of this particular decision, but what I do know is that the governance at Orange Orange has changed. The personnel has changed, Mr. Speaker. We have highly trained professionals who every single day are working in the best
Absolutely.
Interests of those 18,000 patients. We support those people, Mr. Speaker. We support the work that they do, and we made the changes at Orange so that they would be able to do that work unfettered, Mr. Speaker. If there is more information that is required on this particular decision, we will get that for the Leader of the Opposition. But I would think that he would be most
Thank
concerned
you.
About those patients who need the
yes.
support.
Thank you. Any questions? The Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. The Liberal government is paying for an advertising campaign promoting free tuition, but the Premier said herself that it's not really free, and she was uncomfortable calling it free. Can the Premier explain then why her government is advertising something to Ontarians that she says isn't true?
Wow.
Mr. Speaker, the fact is 150,000 students in this province will receive grants that will be the same as or exceed their tuition over each year. Speaker, what I said to the students is, yeah, it needs some explanation, as student assistance has always needed some explanation, Mr. Speaker, because families earn different amounts of money, kids have different circumstances, and so all of that has...
Finish, please.
Of course, all of that has to be taken into account, Mr. Speaker, but the bottom line is 150,000 students in this province will have free tuition who wouldn't have had it before.
Mr. Speaker. Be seated, please. Thank you. Supplementary.
That this Premier is still using the word free. The fact is the Premier herself just said that she's not comfortable using the term free because there are costs.
Stop the clock. I guess I have to give some evidence that I'm not happy with people interjecting. Finish, please.
Yet we see the Premier, Speaker, standing in front of young people with a huge sign that says free tuition. And we hear the President of the Treasury Board and Liberal Cabinet Ministers telling low-income families that they'll get free tuition when the Premier has said publicly herself that that is not true. It's about integrity, Speaker, plain and simple. Will this Premier directly communicate to her Cabinet and staff her lack of comfort at misleading Ontarians? And tell
No. The Leader will withdraw.
Speaker, how on earth can the NDP oppose a proposal that is going to allow 150,000 students to have free tuition? Mr. Speaker, the Canadian Federation of Students, Gabrielle Ross-Marquette, said students have a lot to celebrate today with this commitment to fairness, equity, and justice for students, particularly those from low-income families. Unquote. Mr. Speaker, this is a policy that changes the face of student assistance in this province.
Absolutely.
It allows more students from low and middle-income families to go to post-secondary, whether to college or university, without having to pay tuition, without having to accumulate debt, Mr. Speaker. I would have thought the NDP would support
that. Senator, please. Final supplementary.
We oppose as a two-faced Premier.
Yeah. Order. Order. Stop the clock. Order. The member will withdraw.
Withdraw, Speaker.
Second. Excuse me. And that's the second time in your round I've had to ask you to withdraw. Relax. Please finish.
Speaker, the Premier says her budget doesn't really promise free tuition. But her office, presumably on her behalf, issued a statement saying that they're using those words, quote, deliberately, because we need to fundamentally change the behavior of kids and parents from low-income backgrounds, end quote. Not only is her office saying they're deliberately using a language that is not accurate, but it's completely patronizing and insulting to hard-working, struggling Ontarians.
Question.
Will this Premier apologize for these arrogant and condescending comments made on her behalf and tell her staff that all Ontarians, including low-income families, are
Thank
smart
you.
Enough to understand?
Thank you. Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, again, I think it's astounding that the NDP would take a position against free tuition for 150,000 students. But the fact is, Mr. Speaker, the point of this policy is to make it clear to people, to students and their families in lower and middle income families, Mr. Speaker, that they will have access to post-secondary education that they didn't have access to before,
right.
Mr. Speaker, because the reality is that young people from higher income families are accessing post-secondary at higher rates than low and middle income families. And that's not acceptable to us, Mr. Speaker, nor should it be acceptable to the NDP, nor should it be acceptable to the PCs. It shouldn't be acceptable to anyone in this province that a student would feel that they can't go to post-secondary because of finances. We're changing that, Mr. Speaker. Students will have access. 150,000 students will have free tuition. That's something to be celebrated, not opposed.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Start the clock. New question. The leader of the.
My next question is for the Premier, Speaker. The Premier is advertising free tuition, even though she says it doesn't exist. She promised drivers she would reduce auto insurance rates by 15%, but then she said she had no intention of keeping that promise because it was a stretch goal, Speaker. She promised a five-day wait time for home care. People are waiting 200 days, and she shrugs it off, Speaker. No wonder people are disappointed in this Premier and cynical about this Liberal government. People are much smarter than the Premier gives them credit for. Will this Premier please stop with the communication hype and rein in her arrogance and start treating Ontarians with the respect that they deserve?
So, Mr. Speaker, let me just say that I think one of the things that feeds cynicism is an NDP that is supposed to stand up for people who are marginalized, Mr. Speaker, who is supposed to understand that young people who don't have access to post-secondary education need the support of government, that should understand that the 150,000 students in this province who will have free tuition need the support of government, Mr. Speaker. That, I think, is something that the NDP needs to address, Mr. Speaker. The College Student Alliance says their College Student Alliance is thrilled to see the 2016 budget reflect current realities. By implementing the OSG, the government has committed to a more accessible sector for all students seeking a college education. The leader of the third party might want to talk to the students who are actually going to benefit from this change, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, people hear promises from the Liberals. They read the splashy headlines, but when you take a look, it's obvious that the government is more interested in getting a headline than keeping the promises that they make to the people who are counting on them, Speaker. And the Premier knows it. She said as much last week on Periscope. Why should Ontarians trust this government, Speaker, when it's announcing programs that don't exist and making promises the Premier knows won't be kept?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I want to be very clear with this House and with the people of Ontario. What I said last week was that there needed to be some explanation when students apply for student assistance. That is always the way it has been, Mr. Speaker. It will continue to be. But the fact is that the changes that we have made, which will change the landscape of student assistance in this province, mean that 150,000 students of the 600,000 total in this province who are in post-secondary, 150,000 of those students will have free tuition, Mr. Speaker, or better than free tuition, depending on their circumstances. So, Mr. Speaker, that is free tuition. It changes the way student assistance works in this province. And, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to stand with the student organizations who have been asking for this change, Mr. Speaker. We've made the change, and it will benefit students across the province.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Final supplementary.
Speaker, clarity is exactly what we think, what New Democrats think the people of this province deserve. You either keep your promises or you don't. Students either get free tuition or they don't. Seniors either get home care in 5 days, Speaker, or they don't. Auto insurance rates either come down or they don't. It's no wonder that people are frustrated when this government seems more interested in hyping itself than providing the services and supports that people deserve. When will this premier start showing a little more integrity, or shall I call it clarity?
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this premier broke the barrier for our students to continue their education in the post-secondary system. Mr. Speaker, when it comes to student aid, we are not here to learn a lesson from that party. That is the party, when they were in office, Mr. Speaker, they wanted to eliminate tuition fee for our students, and they ended up doubling it. Mr. Speaker, 150,000 students, they are going to receive free education from our post-secondary universities and colleges. Mr. Speaker, 95% of full-time OSAP eligible students will receive non-repayable Ontario student grants. Mr. Speaker, 90% of dependent college students whose parents earn less than $50,000, they will receive OSAP grants that are greater than average college tuition, and 70% of dependent university students.
Thank you. New question, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Just when we thought it couldn't get any worse, the people of Ontario are learning more about what they're paying for. A culture of luxury and excess this government has allowed over at Metrolinx.
Shameful.
Not only
absolutely
have we
shameful
paid millions for 9 months of near-empty up ghost express trains, but we now learn they wasted thousands more to show off upscale uniforms during Toronto Fashion Week. These guys just don't know when to stop, Speaker, and the Premier seems unwilling to rein
them in. Deputy House Leader.
After learning Metrolinx spent more than $8,000 to cancel the ill-advised fashion fiasco, on top of the $40,000 original design cost, will the Premier do her job and ensure our transit dollars are not wasted any further on valueless vanity projects?
Wow.
Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I want to begin by thanking the member for his question. Of course, I understand this issue is of importance to him and also, of course, to me. I've had the opportunity to convey my concerns to the chair of the Metrolinx board. I have conveyed to him that it's important for all of us to make sure that we continue to focus on our core mandate of planning and building and operating and supporting more transit here in the GTHA and beyond, including to communities like Kitchener-Waterloo, Speaker. And in fact, that is the work that the team at Metrolinx is focused on. I've also informed the chair of the board that that Metrolinx folks will be required to work more closely with the Ministry of Transportation to ensure that going forward that we continue to be completely in alignment with respect to making sure that we deliver on that mandate. I'd be happy to deliver more information in the follow-up question.
Thank you.
Thanks, Speaker.
Speaker, the minister's stated disappointment last week does nothing to restore the taxpayers' money they continue to waste. What a fashion faux pas. I mean, I'm sure we're all disappointed the minister didn't get his chance to do Zoolander's blue steel on the runway in retro chic train couture, but the fact is Metrolinx is charged with transit planning. This needs to be Project Transit, not Project Runway. This premier is charged with overseeing billions in future transit planning through Metrolinx. And yet, we continue to see her allow our precious transit dollars to be wasted again and again. Speaker, will the premier tell us how she expects anyone to trust her to oversee billions in transit investment when we see that money being thrown down the runway?
Thank you.
Well, thanks very much, Speaker. As I said in my first answer to the member opposite, I've already had that conversation with the chair of the board to make sure that we are completely focused on that mandate that I've been given and that Metrolinx has, Speaker. I will say now, for close to 2 years, I've had the privilege of working closely with Board Chair Rob Pritchard, with President and CEO Bruce McQuaig, and with all of the board members and senior executive members at Metrolinx, Speaker. And here's what I've learned. They are an extraordinarily committed group of people who understand their mandate and who are delivering on that mandate, Speaker. In fact, over the last couple of years, what we've seen since 2003, Speaker, is that Metrolinx and GO Transit have, for example, among many other things, built 14 new GO stations, rebuilt 4 existing GO stations, extended our crucial rail network by nearly 90 kilometres, added 31,000 parking spots, added over 200 new rail cars, over 150 new single-level buses, and will add more buses in the years to come. Speaker, we will also deliver.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Welland.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, the Welland Hospital site of the Niagara Health System serves tens of thousands of families in my riding of Welland, some of whom are with us in the gallery here today. The Liberal government has decided to go ahead with plans to close yet another hospital in South Niagara based on a limited and short-sighted report issued in 2012. This was a decision, Speaker, that the Liberal government made without any consultation with families in my community. The so-called restructuring of the Niagara Health System will be one of the largest in Ontario's history, forcing the closure of 5 hospitals in my community and forcing the most vulnerable to travel almost an hour, in some cases more than an hour, to access emergency care. Will the minister explain to this House and to my friends who have joined me today why the Liberal government refuses to reverse this ill-informed and short-sighted decision?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And this decision, of course, and the plans that the Niagara Health System is following, they accepted the recommendations of Dr. Kevin Smith, who spent a great deal of time consulting not only with healthcare professionals, but with literally thousands of members of the Niagara community to come up with a set of recommendations, as well as to ensure that the sustainability of the healthcare system is there for Niagara, but also the highest quality of services that the people deserve. So Niagara Health Systems, with a planning grant that we've provided of $26.2 million already, they're proceeding. They've accepted, the board has accepted those recommendations. They've struck a large committee which has significant community representation, not only representation from municipal leadership and municipal councils, including Welland and Waynefleet, Port Colborne, all of those areas that deserve to have that quality health services. And they're working through a plan which they will at one point be submitting to us. We'll consider it. We'll consider it with the local LIN. We'll make a decision on the basis of that.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. We know that Niagara has one of the highest populations of seniors in the province. The government's decision to close another hospital would mean that a family facing an emergency in my community would have to drive as long as over an hour to reach an emergency department, even longer if you have to rely on public transportation. Worse, occupancy rates currently across the Niagara Health System are at an alarming rate, and the closing of the Welland Hospital will have devastating impacts on capacity levels for the remaining hospitals, putting my community's health at risk. Will the minister put an immediate stop to the short-sighted decision to close the Welland Hospital?
Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, what I won't put a stop to is the community-led process that's guided by the best experts in that region and across the province to determine how to provide the best health services for the people of the Niagara region. In fact, I know that NHS did reveal what their plans are for the Welland location. I know the reaction from the local community. There was a lot of positive reaction to the proposals, including on issues like long-term care, increasing the number of beds, two new buildings, which will provide significant numbers of services. But really, you know, and I know that the member from Welland knows this because she was part of a meeting that I had several weeks ago with the mayors from the regions to discuss specifically this issue, that this is a long process that is being undertaken in an appropriate fashion through the leadership of the NHS, but in close cooperation and consultation with everybody concerned, Mr. Speaker.
Here. Thank you. Your question, the member from Cambridge.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. My riding of Cambridge and North Dumfries is partly rural and home to many family farms, including my neighbours. I know the farmers in my riding are very concerned about safe farming practices and workplace safety, so I was pleased to hear that the Canadian Agricultural Safety Association was once again celebrating Canadian Agricultural Safety Week. Although it's always good to see events that illustrate the importance of farm safety, we also need to be sure that our farmers are aware of potential safety risks and what they can do to mitigate them. In Ontario, we have close to 50,000 farms and 86,000 primary agricultural workers. We need to ensure that we are setting up our farmers to be safe. This is especially significant when we think of children who may be helping out with work on the family farm. Speaker, can the minister please tell this House how Canadian Agricultural Safety Week benefits our farmers?
Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member from Cambridge this morning for a question. I know she spends a lot of time in the North Dumfries part of her riding, which is a great agricultural base of the riding of Cambridge. Last week was the Canadian Agricultural Safety Week, an annual public education campaign which aims to reduce the risk of accidents and hazards on our farms throughout Ontario. Our ministry is proud to work with the Canadian Agricultural Safety Association and the Ontario Federation of Agriculture, recognizing the importance of on-farm safety program. Additionally, we're pleased to support Workplace Safety and Prevention Services of Ontario in their delivery of farm safety education programs across the province. This year's theme is how to be an agri-safe family, and more specifically on keeping kids safe and focused on encouraging children and young adults to remember and stay safe while helping out with the chores and responsibilities on a farm each and every day. As the member mentioned, it's always a tragic event when someone gets injured while working on a farm, and it's only made worse when that individual is indeed a child.
Answer.
By focusing on young farmers, we're encouraging them to develop safe farming practices. And Mr. Speaker, one of the great supporters of agriculture in Ontario, the member from St. Catharines, had a meeting last week with regards to farm safety in the Niagara Peninsula.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister. As we all know, agricultural work is often hazardous and can lead to serious workplace injuries. People in my riding of Cambridge and throughout the Waterloo region work in the agricultural sector and face these inherent risks each and every day. Tragically, when my son was 14 years old, he lost a friend to a farming accident. The teenager had climbed his family's silo to check on the level of corn in the silo when he was overcome by fumes and fell in. Our government understands that the risks involved in the agricultural sector are very real. I understand that in 2006, our government extended the Occupational Health and Safety Act to include farming operations for the first time ever. Speaker, through you to the minister, can you tell my constituents what else our government is doing to protect the health and safety of Ontarians and families who work in our agricultural sector?
Cute minister.
To the Minister of Labour.
Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd really like to thank the member for that excellent question, because we all value the hard work that farmers do every single day. At the Minister of Labour, we know that prevention is the key, that awareness training really helps prevent those workplace accidents. This holds true for farms as well, Speaker. It's not just industry, it's farms as well. Knowing the risks involved in the work and knowing the rights and the responsibilities you have as a worker in Ontario makes all the difference for people to actually work on those farms. I think it's always important that we should remind people to train properly, to be aware of the dangers, and that will help keep everybody safe on the farms. We conduct at the Ministry of Labour both proactive and reactive visits to ensure that we have the best practices in place, and we will charge those, Speaker, those people that aren't living up to their responsibilities. Speaker, we all need to be in this together to make sure that Ontario's farm operations are as safe and as productive as they can be.
Thank you. Any question? The member from Whitby-Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. The Premier says she's worried about the free tuition plan. In fact, the Premier now claims it's free with some explanation required. Alison Jones from the Canadian Press had a headline that read, Wynne says she's worried about pitching tuition is free. However, Speaker, the Premier didn't have a problem calling it free tuition on March the 1st. In fact, the Premier actually responded to four questions that day by shouting to the mountains about free tuition. It's only when students looked at the fine print did the Premier add her asterisk. The Premier knows, Speaker, that the government's original claims of free tuition are simply wrong. Mr. Speaker, this government can't even get free tuition right.
Question?
Can they get anything right?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, as I have said, 150,000 students in this province, Mr. Speaker, will have free tuition. That is the case, Mr. Speaker. And young people who live in families of modest means will have access to post-secondary education in a way they have not had before, Mr. Speaker. Now, I actually understand, coming from the PCs, that this might not be a policy that they would support, Mr. Speaker. But from the NDP, I was very surprised that they wouldn't support young people having more access to post-secondary, and the government playing a role in
that. From Prince Edward Hastings.
So I just want to quote from Spencer Nestico Semenyo from USA, who said, these are sweeping improvements that will dramatically improve financial aid for our students. Students will receive more grants, and for many of them, tuition will be free. The fact is, Mr. Speaker, the Ontario University Student Association has been advocating for these changes. The student groups have been asking us to make these changes. We have, and
sir,
students will have free tuition. Those 150,000 students will have free tuition, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
Thank you. Parliamentary.
Speaker, again to the Premier. When is free not free? When this Liberal government gets their hands on a plan, we see it time and time again, Speaker. Just look at the spin. Some explanation required. There's caveats. The program will evolve. That's all, and more aspirational stretch goals. That's all we ever get from this government.
Yeah.
Just when you thought, Speaker, it couldn't get any worse, the Liberals are taking away $165 million worth of tax credits from students.
Oh.
Mr. Speaker, will the Premier come clean? Will the Premier admit this isn't about helping students? This is about distracting from the government's scandal, waste, and mismanagement.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for that question, Mr. Speaker. And also I want to remind the member that his party voted against 30% off tuition grant in the past. And his party was actually wanted to abolish almost that, Mr. Speaker. They wanted to give the student aid based on merit, not on the need of the students. Mr. Speaker, 250,000 students, 80% of OSAP eligible students, they will have less debt than they would have under current OSAP. Mr. Speaker, 95% of OSAP eligible students will receive non-repayable Ontario student grants, and 150,000 students, they are going to receive grants from the government which will be equal or even maybe more than their tuition fee. Mr. Speaker, as I said earlier, this Premier broke the barrier for low-income students to continue their education in our colleges and universities.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings, second time. New question. The member from Windsor-Tecumseh.
Thank you, Speaker. My question this morning is for the Minister of Health. Good morning, Minister. Seniors in Windsor and Tecumseh are worried about the Liberal plan to nearly double the cost of their prescription drugs. Under the Liberal budget, the cost of the deductible for the vast majority of seniors will increase by 70% this summer. Speaker,
Deputy House Leader, second time.
Fixed income simply can't afford this. People are already struggling to pay the rent and put food on the table. My question to the minister is simple and straightforward. Exactly how many of Ontario's 2 million seniors will be forced to pay more for their prescription drugs because of this Liberal government?
Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I know some erroneous information has been out there, which doesn't accurately reflect the number of seniors that will benefit from this program. And the truth is, Mr. Speaker, that roughly 25% of Ontario's 2 million seniors will benefit from paying no annual deductible at all. So there's a significant number, 173,000, who are currently paying a $100 annual deductible that will join roughly 300,000.
The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek, come to order. Finish, please.
Join more than a quarter of a million other low-income, the lowest-income seniors that will pay no annual deductible, roughly 25% of the total seniors in this province. It's pretty remarkable that that number that will transition
Answer.
Into that positive space, Mr. Speaker. And there are also other important changes that we've made that reflect that we are the most generous by far province in the entire
Thank you.
Country with regards to...
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, obviously, by the mathematical gobbledygook, you're refusing to tell us how many seniors are going to be paying more for their prescription drugs. Our seniors aren't rich, Speaker. They watch every penny. The Premier wants to nearly double the cost of their prescriptions. This is the wrong thing to do. We should be expanding access to universal prescription drugs, not forcing seniors to pay more, Speaker. When will the minister stop making excuses, actually stand up for the seniors in this province, and put a stop to the Premier's plan?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I implore, in fact, I'm begging the NDP to just one time in this legislature mention that 170,000 more seniors, the lowest income seniors, those that party would purport to support, Mr. Speaker, but I don't understand why it's impossible for them to actually reference that positive development. So in Canada, the out-of-pocket expenses for seniors in this province is $277 per year. The next closest province is more than twice that. In fact, some provinces, the out-of-pocket expenditures are as high as $1,000 a year. This is a very progressive policy. It means that those that can afford it will be asked to pay a little bit more. But a quarter of the seniors, those low-income seniors that I would have hoped the NDP would support this process, but that's the old NDP.
Thank you.
They can't mention that number.
Thank you. New question? The member from Durham.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the minister responsible for the Anti-Racism Directorate. In 1966, the General Assembly of the United Nations first proclaimed March 21st as the International Day for the Elimination of Racism and Discrimination. This day commemorates the Sharpeville Massacre, a day where police opened fire and killed 69 peaceful protesters, demonstrating against South Africa's apartheid, quote-unquote, passed law. While this was overt racism, we know that in Ontario there still exists a number of individual, cultural, and systemic barriers that prevent racial minorities from realizing true equality. Speaker, could the minister inform the members of this House about what Ontario has done to address racism?
Thank you. Minister of Tourism, Culture, Sport.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank the MPP for Durham for the question. Today marks the 50th anniversary of the International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, a day that annually, it's an important day. This day reminds us to fight racism and related forms of intolerance and discrimination worldwide. Ontario has been a long champion of equality and an international beacon for cultural pluralism. Ontario was the first jurisdiction in Canada to prohibit discrimination based on race when it passed the Ontario Human Rights Code. Ontario was the birthplace of the Human Rights Commission in Canada. By 1977, other jurisdictions, including the federal government, would follow Ontario's leadership and create their own commissions. Recently, I joined the Premier to demonstrate Ontario's continued leadership on this file through our Anti-Racism Directorate. And I look forward to keeping the members of this House up to date on an ongoing basis on this incredible
Answer.
Initiative.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister. When the Premier announced the Anti-Racism Directorate, she highlighted dynamics that have refocused modern issues. Movements like Black Lives Matter, the ongoing issue of police street checks, and the debate surrounding the Syrian refugee crisis. It is clear that we need to take greater and more coordinated action against racism. It has only been 1 month since the directorate was announced, and I understand that there is still a lot more work to be done. But, Speaker, could the minister inform the members of this House how our government is laying the foundation for the new anti-racism directorate?
Good question.
Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And again, I want to thank the member for Durham. Ontario's new anti-racism directorate was formed to remove social and economic barriers that prevent our province from achieving true equality and to apply a wide anti-racism lens to government policy. Over the past month, I've had the opportunity to work with a lot of people at the ministry, and we've hired a new associate deputy minister to take a lead with the directorate. And I've also had a few meetings with important stakeholders, community-based organizations, and the Ontario Human Rights Commission. And I've met with partners like the Colour of Poverty and the Council of Agencies Serving South Asians. The Anti-Racism Directorate is determining how we can help fight racism to ensure that everyone here in Ontario has equal opportunity to succeed. In the coming months, I'm committed to continuing engaging, collaborating with stakeholders and partners to achieve true equality here in the province of Ontario.
Thank you. Question? The member from Melbourne, Middlesex, London.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Speaker, this government has failed Shania Page. Ms. Page is a young woman suffering from a mental illness. As Christina Blizzard of the Toronto Sun noted, this isn't a human tragedy of immense proportion. And she wrote, and I quote, "It's an infuriating, terrifying, and a pathetic indictment of the hypocrisy we spout about mental illness in this province."
Sorry, the member will withdraw. You cannot quote something from the outside that you can't say here, so please withdraw.
I'll withdraw. Mr. Speaker, this was a case of someone who was in desperate need of mental health services and couldn't get the help she needed. Mr. Speaker, is the minister embarrassed he tells people to seek help while the very help they need isn't there because this government has cut it?
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and the member opposite is correct. This is a very, very serious issue, and it's one that I personally take very seriously. It's also a complex issue, but there's no question that we need to ensure, Mr. Speaker, when an individual is facing a mental health crisis, that they're provided at that moment of time, in time, they're provided with the right supports that they need in order that the correct pathway is followed. Yeah. We don't want to see those individuals moving where there could potentially be a violent episode against themselves or other persons, or where there could to head down that path of the criminal justice system, because that's the wrong path for these individuals. We need to make sure, and we need to invest in money that will go to provide those supports at that moment of time so that the person gets the right supports, that they get connected with the emergency services that they require, the community resources that they require, the primary care resources that they need to be stabilized and get better.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the minister. Minister, you're a lot of talk with zero action. It's been over a decade, and you keep saying the same things over and over, and more people are dying or ending up in our correction services with zero supports. You would have thought this government, Mr. Speaker, would have learned something from the death of Ashley Smith in 2007. Her death in solitary confinement in a Kitchener institution was tragic. But just when you thought things couldn't get any worse, this government continues to cut much-needed mental health services. This government loves to talk and tweet about Bell Let's Talk Day, but failed to actually offer any real help to those in need. Mr. Speaker, what will it take? How many more people will have to die before this government takes funding mental health services seriously?
Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I can't believe that the member opposite would take an individual's crisis and use it for such political partisan reasons. We're investing over $3 billion in our health care system specific to mental health and addictions. That continues to go up each and every year. $137 million new dollars over the next 3 years as we engage in a new phase of mental health supports.
The member asked the question. Come to order, please. And the member behind you, the member from Prince Edward Hastings, is warned. Finish, please.
Over $810 million last year alone for our community mental health supports across this province. I know there's more work to be done. Of course, we'll never reach that point of providing those supports that individuals need unless we work together, implement the best advice that we're getting from, for example, the Leadership Advisory Council that we have that has advising me, making those important investments and making sure that individuals who are facing these crises and these challenges get the support they need.
The question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Last week, I traveled to northwestern Ontario along with the member for Kenora Rainy River and met with Grand Chief Fiddler, Deputy Grand Chief Fox, and other leaders from the Nan communities. We heard from Chief Cutfoot about how few in his community have regular access to doctors, nurses, or specialists for diseases such as diabetes, which is rampant throughout the Nan territories. Sioux Lookout has the highest rate of rheumatic fever in the world, Speaker, a treatable, preventable, yet deadly illness if not acted on. In fact, 2 4-year-old children have died from this preventable illness in the last 2 years. This is 2016, Speaker. The Premier has been the critic for Aboriginal Affairs. She knows these problems exist. Why is she doing nothing to change such an intolerable situation?
Thank you.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, we in this government take this issue very seriously. I have been in contact with Chief Fiddler on a number of occasions. When this most recent situation developed, I was in contact with him. We are working on ways to deal with this issue. This situation is not going to continue. We are making every effort at the Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs, working in collaboration with other ministries, the Minister of Health, the Minister of the Environment, and indeed other ministries across government. We are taking a whole-of-government approach to this. Last week, I was in northwestern Ontario, and I had several discussions about this issue as it involved climate change and as it involved safe drinking water. It's all a part of the whole.
Answer.
We have to tackle these issues as an entity. We are doing that as a government.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, I would say that not much is going on when it comes to what this government claims their relationship is with First Nations communities. 3 weeks ago, the Anishinaabe Aski Nation declared a health care state of emergency in this province. They're reeling from endemic suicides, living in poor, crowded housing conditions, and their communities have undrinkable water. And they have for decades, Speaker. None of these problems are new. They have existed for decades. Will this Premier act today to address the dire health crisis in Sioux Lookout, in the region, and across the Nan territories, and stop the suicides that are occurring there?
Thank you.
Minister of Health.
Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're taking this very seriously, and frankly, I agree with Chief Fiddler when he declared the state of emergency for the population represented by Nan. And Mr. Speaker, I've talked with Chief Fiddler, I've talked with Regional Chief Isidore Day. In fact, next week I'm going to be sitting down with those chiefs and others and Federal Health Minister Jane Philpott to specifically and emphatically discuss this state of emergency and what we need to do collectively at all levels of government to be able to address this. And the party opposite knows that this is not something that can be solved overnight. The prudent thing is to have these conversations, to actually work with First Nations rather than without, which seems to be what they would suggest doing, to actually work on a collaborative action plan which will, in a significant, tangible, realistic way, begin to address these issues. I'm looking forward as well to the federal Liberal budget tomorrow. I've got confidence that it's going to speak to some of these issues with regards to First Nations as well.
Yeah. The member for Kingston and the Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. Last Thursday, the minister was in Thunder Bay to announce that the Ontario government would be making a significant investment through the Green Investment Fund to provide First Nations communities with the training, tools, and infrastructure they need to address climate change. Climate change is a matter of concern for all Ontarians, which is why our government has taken small and large steps over the many years to help reduce Ontario's impact. Climate change will also dramatically affect Indigenous communities, jeopardizing First Nations and Métis way of life, health territories, and resources. Can the minister tell us more about these investments?
Thank you. Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you. Speaker, it was a pleasure to be joined last week by my colleagues, the members for Thunder Bay Superior North and Thunder Bay Atikokan, at the Ontario First Nations Technical Services Corporation last week to announce this important new initiative. First Nation communities, Laurentian University's Ontario Centre for Climate Impact and Adaptation. We will be working with First Nations and the University to develop adaptation plans to help First Nation communities prepare for the effects of climate change, to build the technical capacity in order for First Nation communities to take advantage of cap and trade, and to develop a Northern Ontario climate change impact study using the data from these adaptation plans. Speaker, ensuring First Nations have the tools they need to fight and adapt to climate change is important. First Nations and our universities will work together. They will combine their unique skills and special knowledge.
Thank you.
This is the best way to do it.
Excellent.
Supplementary.
It's great to hear that our government recognizes the importance of engaging Indigenous communities on climate change. It's clear that our government is committed to working with Indigenous people in Ontario to address the impacts of climate change felt by their communities. I understand that our government is also taking steps to help promote First Nations communities reduce their dependency on diesel fuel. This will help them develop the capacity to become more self-sufficient through the use of renewable energy and open up economic opportunities. Can the minister please tell us more about how this government is supporting Indigenous communities towards this goal?
Thank you, Minister.
Good question.
Mr. Speaker, I also announced last week that Ontario will invest $8 million to develop advanced micro-solutions to remote First Nation communities. Continuous diesel-fired electricity generation in our remote First Nation communities emits an estimated 65 metric kilotons of greenhouse gases annually. This is equivalent to about 15,000 cars on the road. This is not healthy for those northern communities. It is not healthy for our province. A shift to microgrids from diesel fuel is vital in our fight against climate change. It is imperative that we begin preparing First Nation communities to adapt to climate change now. And I look forward to working with our partner First Nations to see that real progress is made in this issue. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, member from Brampton, Kent, Middlesex.
Well, good morning, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Minister of Health. Earlier this year, the Chatham-Kent Health Alliance was told they'd be getting $2.5 million less than they were expecting from the province's Minister of Health. Speaker, we have seen cuts to nursing positions and physician services across the province, and now my constituents are worried the services they depend on may be next on the chopping block. Mr. Speaker, does the minister have any plans to cut more services at the Sydenham District Hospital in Wallaceburg over the next fiscal year?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think from that question, the sense I'm getting from that member opposite is that there might be an inkling that he would support our budget this year. Because we have a 1% increase in the base for hospitals, every single hospital across the province. In fact, we're providing even additional funds for hospitals which are designated rural or small, plus $350 million, which is going to our hospitals across the province, which is actually works out to about 2.1% increase in the budget. On average for our hospitals across the province. So these are important investments. I'm happy to talk to him about the specific concern that he has. But the truth is, Mr. Speaker, is we're increasing our hospital funding, and it will make a significant difference right across the board to the level of service
that
people deserve in Ontario. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, back to the Minister of Health. Speaker, over the last week, people in Wallaceburg, Walpole Island First Nations, and throughout Chatham-Kent told me that they are very worried about the future of the emergency department at the Sydenham District Hospital. The facts are that 13 years of Liberal scandals, waste, and mismanagement are responsible for taking away funding for essential services like health care. Speaker, the people of Wallaceburg, Walpole Island, and Chatham-Kent depend on Sydenham Hospital's emergency department. So my question this morning is very simple. Is the emergency department at the Sydenham Hospital going to remain open as a fully functioning 24-hour emergency department?
Question. Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, there's nothing that I'm aware of that would change the level and quality of health care provided to the patients in Chatham-Kent. But I do want, because the hospital reference, but I do want to mention, because you mentioned Chatham-Kent as well, if we can talk about that area for a minute, because there was a very important development that took place just in the past few days with regards to the hospital in Leamington, because I think this legislature knows that we provided over $1 million to try to attract obstetricians and gynecologists to that hospital to keep the birthing center, to keep that obstetrics ward open. Well, there is the first obstetrician confirmed that he is coming to Leamington, and I'm very proud to announce that that obstetrics unit, that birthing center, will remain open, and it has a new obstetrician, Mr. Speaker.
Answer. Thank you. Good question. The member from Park Day, Hyde Park.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation. Last week, we learned that Metrolinx spent tens of thousands of public dollars to design special fashionable uniforms for the Union Pearson Express, and spent thousands more to get the uniforms featured during Fashion Week in Toronto, only to later drop out of the event. We know Metrolinx does nothing without the approval of the Minister of Transportation, and it was the current Premier who committed to the UP Express's flawed business model 6 years ago when she was Transportation Minister. But instead of taking responsibility for UP Express, the Minister has scapegoated public servants who were only doing what they were told to do. Will the Minister stop pretending that Metrolinx is independent of his ministry and finally accept responsibility
Question.
For the UP Express blunders?
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I thank the member from Parkdale High Park for her question. As I said earlier today, I have had the chance to speak with or communicate with the chair of the Metrolinx board. There's a very clear understanding that we will, the Ministry of Transportation and Metrolinx will continue to work closely together as we fulfill the mandate that the people of Ontario have given this government for Metrolinx and the ministry to design, build, operate, support and sustain additional transit. Speaker, earlier today I had the chance at length to mention a number of the initiatives that we've moved forward with, that we've had tremendous success with, that we've made more progress on. Speaker, there is a significant, as we all know, a significant requirement to make sure that we continue to invest in transit here in the 416, in the 905 and beyond across the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area. And I have no doubt, Speaker, that the team at Metrolinx, with whom I've worked closely now for close to 2 years, will continue to work with us to fulfill that mandate. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Back to the minister. Whenever Metrolinx has appeared in the newspaper recently, it hasn't been exactly good news. Union Pearson Express trains with expensive uniforms, but few passengers. A mile-long bridge carving through the Davenport community without public agreement. A gas plant suddenly appearing in plans for the Eglinton crosstown, again without public consultation. How can the public trust Metrolinx to serve the public interest and spend billions in public dollars when the ministry is making the real decisions behind closed doors without any public support?
Thank you. Mr.
Thanks very much, Speaker. Well, I have to say I categorically reject the premise of that member's question on the follow-up, Speaker. Just a few days ago, the Premier of Ontario, thanks in large part to her leadership, stood alongside the team at Metrolinx and other members from this caucus at the Kielsdale station for the Eglinton Crosstown, Speaker. Let's remember that the Eglinton Crosstown, at $5.3 billion, is the single largest public transit project in Ontario history, and it's taking place because this Premier and this government have made the commitment and made the hard decisions to build transit, Speaker. And we're building that transit, working closely, of course, with Metrolinx. What would be most helpful in this legislature occasionally, Speaker, is if members of the NDP would support the budgets that we put forward that will help us fund the transit that they allege that they think we need in this region. Thanks very much, Speaker.
The member from Etobicoke North on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I respectfully invite all members of the Legislature to a reception held by the Turkish-Canadian community, the Anatolian Heritage Foundation, taking place immediately after question period in rooms 228 and 230. Thank you, Speaker.
I am going to take a moment just to offer some advice and a request. The advice is that I believe that every member in this House knows or should know of the type of language that is not parliamentary. And I also would also include staff who may help you with questions, putting them into the question. They should know or do know that it's unparliamentary. I've heard too many things over the last little while that imply that you're saying it for the theater effect, and I'm going to have to start clamping down even tighter than what I am. So I'm asking all members to cooperate. You know what you cannot say, and I think it has to stop. Thank you. There are no deferred votes. This House stands adjourned until 1 p.m. this afternoon.